Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about electrical braking of synchronous motors. We know that in synchronous machines, electromagnetic torque is produced only when the relative speed between the stator and the rotor fields is zero. That means if the stator is rotating at some speed, the rotor MMF or the rotor field also should rotate at the same speed, then only the torque can be produced, otherwise it cannot be produced. So this is applicable for any type of electrical machines. So this is possible only in the case of single excitation. That means, for example, if you take the induction motor, in the case of induction motor, it is a singly excited device. It is a singly excited device. So in the single excited device, what is the advantage? Whatever is the stator, so let us assume there is a stator, so different conductors, RYB phase sequence is there. So it will rotate at a speed NS. So in the rotor, the EMF will be induced because of stator. So as the EMF is induced because of the stator, the rotor MMF also will rotate at same speed. So that the relative speed between the stator and rotor MMF will be zero. Let us take, for example, my induction motor is rotating at a speed of N. But the field that is produced or the EMF that is induced will be at slip frequency. So a rotating magnetic field will be produced there, which will rotate at slip times the speed. That means this rotating magnetic field will produce at a speed in the same direction at slip times the frequency, corresponding to slip times the speed. So if you take the relative, that means if a person is standing here, if you take what is the speed of rotor rotating field, the speed of rotor rotating field will be speed of the rotor N plus it is coming at NS minus N times NS minus N speed will be the speed of the rotor induced flux with respect to the rotor. So your net speed will be this NN will cancel. So your net speed is NS. That means with respect to stator, always rotor MMF is rotating at a speed NS, or with respect to stator MMF, rotor MMF is stationary. That's why the torque is produced in induction motor also. So same thing is applicable for the case of synchronous machine. In the case of synchronous machine, what we do? We apply the three phase supply. So like RYB, let us take it as R, Y and B. You may confuse with this. So RYB. So because of this, a rotating magnetic field will produce in this sequence, which will rotate at a speed of NS. So now this rotor should also rotate at a speed of NS. So then only the both the locking will happen between them and the torque will be produced in that case. If the relative speed between the stator and the rotor is not zero, then in that case the torque will be zero. Because in this case the rotor, whatever the field is there, that is independent of the stator MMF. That's why, because whatever is the speed the stator is running, it will automatically not imply on the rotor. So we have to rotate the rotor or do some mechanism so that the relative speed between these two will be equal to zero. Only in that case the torque will be produced. If you have any queries related to this, you can refer to the torque produced in the induction motor. So there I have explained in complete detail how the torque is produced, how the relative speed is zero. So now let us proceed further. So we have seen in the case of induction motors and DC motors that different types of brakings are possible. The first one we have seen there, regenerative braking. So in the case of regenerative braking, what we will do? We will run the speed of the rotor will be greater than the speed of the stator rotating MMF or stator rotating field. So as NR is greater than NS or the slip is equal to negative, so EMF is induced in that. Same thing is the case for the DC motor also. DC motor, actually that rotor is rotated at a speed higher than the normal speed, so the EMF is generated and it is fed back, because back EMF will be greater than your supply voltage and because of the EMF is fed back. But if you are running your rotor greater than NS, then the relative speed, that is NS minus NR, is not equal to zero. So that's why regenerative braking cannot be applied for the case of synchronous motor. So this method cannot be applied. Let us take the second method. The second method we have seen is plugging. So in the case of plugging, so what we will do? The supply sequence is reversed. That means if initially your phase sequence is RYB, so your phase sequence is reversed, that is RYB is changed like this. That means initially it is rotating like this in NS. Now it will rotate in opposite direction at a speed of NS. So this is what the phase sequence. So in that case also, now you can see this is NS and your rotor, because initially inertia is there, so it will rotate in this direction at a speed of NS. So the relative speed between this will be NS plus this NS, or otherwise let us assume the rotor speed, because it decays with respect to time. This I can take as NR plus NS. So this is the relative speed. Again, relative speed is not equal to zero. As a relative speed is not equal to zero, so this method also cannot be applied for production of torque in synchronous machine. But this method can be applied only if there is that projected poles or the salient pole machine, the salient pole machine which is having the damper windings, because the damper windings can act as an induction motor and damper windings can produce some torque. That means the torque can be produced only due to damper winding. But generally the torque that is produced by the damper winding is very less. So in practice this cannot be used for plugging operation. That means torque will be produced but the magnitude is very less. That is not going to affect so much or do the useful work in our case. That means we can conclude that for a synchronous machine, we cannot go for regenerative braking and plugging. Then what method will be better for this? So the method that is used is the rheostatic or dynamic braking. So this is the method that is used. In rheostatic or dynamic braking, what we have to do, I have already told you, if a machine is a singly excited device, then automatically the second EMF will be induced will have the same speed as your the which is producing it. So the issue will solve. So what you have to do, let us take, this is my rotor which is having a north pole and a south pole. This is my stator. So now it will be disconnected from the supply, whatever RYB are there, this will be disconnected from the supply and they will be connected to some external resistance. Let us assume these are my resistance. So this will be connected here. So second winding will be connected as well as the third winding will be connected. So this is the variable resistance bank. So now you can see here only rotor is rotating at a speed nr. So let us, because speed will decay with respect to time, let us take it as nr. It is rotating at a speed of nr. Because of this, EMF will be induced in the stator. Because of the EMF induced in the stator, the current will pass through this. So this current is dissipated in the external circuits. That means whatever the moment of inertia of the rotor is there, that will lead to the production of EMF in the stator, which will be dissipated in the external resistances. So only using this method we can go for the braking in the case of synchronous machine. So this is used practically. So again, in this there are two different possible ways of doing it. First one is in the normal case, that means your field is maintained constant. That means IF is maintained constant. If IF is maintained constant, we know the EMF induced is depending on the field flux as well as the speed of the rotor. What is the relative speed between the stator and the rotor? That leads to the respect to frequency and the magnitude. Everyone agree with me? So with respect to time, what will happen? Because the moment of inertia, because you are dissipating the energy, nr will goes on decaying, so automatically E will go on decreasing. So when E is decreased, automatically this leads to decrease in the current, because the torque depends on the current. So the electromagnetic torque or this dynamic braking torque, so let us take the dynamic braking torque as TD, so TD also will goes on decreasing. Or otherwise, we can tell that in this case, the dynamic braking torque is proportional to the value of speed of the rotor. Generally, we represent in angular velocity. So that's why I'm representing with omega suffix r instead of n. For this, I can write as TD is equal to K times of WR. The dynamic braking torque is proportional to K times of WR. So that means we can tell that the dynamic braking torque is continuously changing with respect to change in WR. This is the first condition. Now there is a second type that is possible. The second type possible is you will vary the value of IF in such a way that the dynamic braking torque TD is maintained constant. That means dynamic braking torque is maintained constant by adjusting the value of the field and other parameters. So in that case, how your machine will try to operate. So those things we are going to discuss. So in this class, I am going to discuss the first one, and second one we will discuss in the next class with the numericals. So let us take the first one. So I am taking braking torque is proportional to speed. Braking torque is proportional to speed. So we can tell that TD is proportional to speed. So K into this is angular velocity of the rotor. Or from this we can tell my total braking torque. This is my total braking torque. So this total braking torque will be TD plus TL. TD is the dynamic braking torque and TL is my load torque. Because the load is also connected to it, load will try to oppose also, because that also produce some torque. So this will be, can be written as K times of omega R plus TL, or this I can write as minus J into dWR by dt. So this J is the moment of inertia. Moment of inertia, and this negative sign is used for indicating that the speed decays with respect to time. As the speed decreases with respect to time, that is why minus sign is given. J is given dWR by dt, where omega r or WR is the speed of the rotor in angular velocity. It is the angular velocity, t is the time taken. So this I can write as this equation I am just rewriting here. So then we will reformulate it. So TD plus TL we got as minus J into d omega divided by dt. So this is what we got. So from this I can write my value Td is equal to minus J divided by TL plus K times of WR into d omega R. So I can do the integration of this. If you do the integration, you will get the T is equal to minus J by K into ln of TL plus K times of WR plus some constant C. Let us take this as equation number 1. So now I want to evaluate what is this constant, proportionality constant. So for that I can substitute my initial conditions. So I am taking at time t is equal to 0, omega r will be equal to omega s. So I am just substituting in equation number 1. So I can write 0, because time is equal to 0, is equal to minus j by k into ln of tl plus k times of, because that wr will be equal to ws. So this is the value, plus c. So from this I can calculate my value of C. C is equal to J by K ln of this one. So I am directly substituting in the time. So we get the time T is equal to J by K ln of TL plus K times of WS divided by TL plus K times of WR. So this is the time we got. So this is, let us take it as equation number 2. Getting it? So I hope this is clear to you. So from this I can just make the further simplification. So this I can write as TL plus K times of WS divided by TL plus K times of WR. So this I can write as, because the thing will go here, so K into T by J, and ln if you are taking in the second side, it becomes e to the power of minus K by J into T, e to the power of minus K by J into T. So this is what we get. Okay, so now from this I can calculate my value of omega r. That means I can rearrange this. So if you rearrange this, you will get it as 1 by k into TL plus k times of WS e to the power of minus k by j into T minus TL. So let us take it as equation number 3. We got the equation for omega r. So let us see how we can correlate further so that I can calculate the number of revolutions that takes before stopping. So we can write the angular speed in radians per second. So that I can give as represented by omega r. This will be equal to d theta by dt, where theta is the total angular rotation in time. Let us assume the time taken is in t seconds, total time. But we know the value of the theta, because this theta can be represented as, because in one revolution it will make 2 pi radians. Let us assume r is the number of revolutions made. So r is the number of revolutions before stopping. That means number of revolutions it takes for stopping. That means up to the time of stopping in time t seconds. Let us assume it is stopping in time t seconds. So from this I can calculate omega r is equal to d by dt of this theta. I can substitute, this will be equal to 2 pi into r. So from this I can calculate my value of r is equal to 1 by 2 pi integration of omega r into dt. So let us take this as equation number 4. So we have just derived the value of omega r. So that omega r I am substituting here from equation number 3. So from equation number 3, so substitute equation number 3 in equation number 4. So from this I can calculate my value of r is equal to 1 by 2 pi integration of omega r is 1 by k into TL plus k times of WS e to the power of minus k by j into T minus TL. So this is the value is there. So this will be dt. So if you do the integration, you will get it as 1 by 2 pi k, because k is the constant I can take out. This becomes minus j by k TL plus k times of WS e to the power of minus k by j into T minus TL into T plus some constant. Again, some proportionality constant comes. So this proportionality constant I can get from the initial condition. That means at time t is equal to 0, that at a particular instant the number of revolutions will be equal to 0. So therefore, from this I can calculate my value of C. C is equal to, just substitute in this equation, you will get it as 1 by 2 pi k into j by k plus into TL plus k times of WS. So if you are substituting this value of C there, so you will get the value of R as 1 by 2 pi k into J by K into TL plus K times of WS into 1 minus e to the power of minus K by J into T minus TL into T. So you can please try to check it. So you will get this value of R. Getting it? So the total time that is taken before it stop, the time taken before it stop, we have just derived the value of the T. The T we have derived as J by K into ln of TL plus K times of omega S plus TL plus K times of omega R. So at that particular instant, whatever is the value of omega R, if you substitute, we will get until we reach the value of that omega R, what is the time taken. So finally, omega R will become equal to 0. So you have to substitute omega R is equal to 0 to know the total time that is taken to stop. So from this, I can calculate my value, total time T before it stops. So I am just writing here because it will be useful for the numerical. So this I can write as J by K ln of TL plus K times of omega S divided by TL plus K times of omega R will be 0. So this way you have to calculate. This is my total time taken. Getting it? So let us take one numerical so that whatever the derivation we have done, that will be completely clear to you, or you can easily understand what we have discussed. So let us try to calculate that one now. So for that, I am taking an a 3-phase 375 rpm synchronous motor and its driving equipment have a total moment of inertia. Moment of inertia is given 500 kg per meter square. Speed is given 375 rpm and a constant frictional torque of 150 newton meters. Calculate the time required by this electric drive to come to rest and the number of revolutions made during the retardation process when rheostatic braking with field current and resistances held constant at a value that gives an initial braking torque of 6 kilo newton meters. So this is what is asked. So let us try to calculate this. So it is given there initial braking torque, that braking torque is given by equal to 6 kilo newtons, that means 6000 newton meters. So at time t is equal to 0, we know W will be equal to WS. So we can tell that K times of WS will be equal to 6000 newton meters. Okay, this is the value. So from this, I can calculate my value of the K. K is equal to 6000 divided by 39.27. So this becomes 152.7 newton meter seconds per radian. This is what we get. And it is also given that the speed is given. So we can calculate omega S is equal to 2 pi into the speed given is 375 divided by 60. So this will come as 39.27. This is in radians per second. This is the second one we got. So now the load torque is also given. Load torque or the frictional torque, this is given as 150 newton meters. Okay. So we got the value of TL also. We got the value of TD. And now we calculated the value of K. So now we have calculated the value of omega S also. Now the time taken for stopping, I can calculate by J by K into ln of TL plus K times of WS divided by TL. So this is what the equation we have previously. So I am just substituting there. So if you substitute there, this is 500. This is 152.79 into ln of 150 plus 152.79 into 39.27 divided by 150. So this will come as 12.153 seconds. So this is the time taken to completely stop. So number of revolutions made before stopping, that is equal to 1 by 2 pi k into J by K into TL plus K times of WS into 1 minus e to the power of K by J into T minus TL into T. This is what we got. So if you just substitute the values, so you will get this value as 18.55 revolutions. So you can just substitute the values, all the values there. I have directly written the answer. I hope this basic concept of braking, that means dynamic or rheostatic braking with the torque that is proportional to the speed, is clear to you. So in the next class, we are going to discuss about the second case. That means if the dynamic braking torque is maintained constant, how what will be the time taken for stopping and how many number of revolutions it will rotate before stopping. So if you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.